Okay, class, turn to pages 741 in your textbooks as we'll be going over chapters 12 and 13 today.
One proportion and two proportion, C and D tests.
What's up, Wade? We haven't learned 12 and 13 yet. Just, we're in SAS class
we're
right now.
We're learning it now.
We're just, what? Six? Six assignments? We haven't even learned stuff yet. Wait, do not hang up on me, Wade.
What's going on?
We have to learn chapters 12 and 13.
On our
two
own.
Days.
Uh-oh.
And we have six assignments.
Six assignments? Who's the villain?
That's the confusing thing. We don't know.
Impossible.
Rob, where in the world are we going to find this first clue?
I don't know.
It's like impossible. Oh, look!
Well, there it is.
Here's the clue! Let's see what it says.
Okay.
The one sample T statistic for a test of H null, mu equals 10. Alternative hypothesis, mu is less than 10, and that's based on n equals 10 observations, has the value t equals negative 2.25. What are the degrees of freedom for this statistic? Between what two probabilities from table C does the p-value of the test fall? Answer, if you dare. Assignment one.
This is sick, Wade. Hey, where's Rufus? Now there you are. Alrighty. Now that we got that under control, what do we do for this assignment?
Ron, Kim, what's the assignment?
Well, we have to find the degrees of freedom for this statistic.
But how do we do that?
Degrees of freedom in a one-sample hypothesis test are the sample size minus one. Copy?
Copy. So that's pretty easy. Sample size is 10, so we just do n minus one. That gives us 9 degrees of freedom.
Okay,
check.
Now what?
Now you guys must use table C.
You have table C?
Right here.
Oh, I see. So our degrees of freedom was 9.
Mm-hmm.
And our t value was 2.25.
Across the side, find your degrees of freedom.
Here it is.
Now look for the values that 2.25 falls between.
Falls between 1.833 and 2.262.
These are your answers.
And that goes with the probability of 0.05 and 0.025.
You guys have completed your task.
Well done, Ron.
Next assignment.
Impossible.
Well, now that we've solved the problem, how do we find the next clue?
Look, an E.
An E?
That's strange.
What do you think that stands for?
I don't know. Let's go find the next clue.
Where are we gonna look, though? I mean, this school is huge. Hey, what's that?
Another E.
This can only mean one thing.
The examinator. He probably got this from the vending machine. Let's go.
Impossible.
Found the vending machine.
Look, there's the clue.
Looking for a drink?
Roof, attack. Look, found the second assignment.
Another E.
Good job, Rufus.
Ron, what's that?
Nothing.
Okay.
Let's go.
Alright.
Impossible.
Alright, let's see what the second clue says.
A survey was done on the amount of drinks that jam a vending machine yearly. A mere 3% of all drinks were calculated across the United States. In an SRS, 2 of 300 drinks were calculated that jammed a vending machine.
Is this good enough evidence to say 3% of all vending machine drinks will jam the vending machine? Carry out a significance test.
Construct and interpret a 95% confidence interval for the proportion of all vending machine drinks that jam a vending machine.
What's the sitch, Wade?
In order to conduct your hypothesis test, you must follow HATS. First, you need to state your hypothesis. Then you must make your assumptions. Your three assumptions are normality, an SRS, and independence.
Let's see. Based on the problem, we can assume that they're independent and that they're an SRS because it's stated in the problem. And normality is also stated in the problem. So those are all three are checks. And our null hypothesis is that p hat equals 0.03. And our alternate hypothesis is that the sample proportion p hat does not equal 0.03.
Now on to T. You must conduct your test.
A one proportion Z test.
So, in our calculator, we have a stat test, one proportion Z test, and our p-value, what we compare to, is 0.03, as stated in the problem. And our x?
X would be 300.
So it would be 300. And our n would be?
Oh, no, x would be 2, n would be 300. And that would be our sample proportion of the amount of drinks jammed in the machine.
And we want to make sure we have not equal to.
Yes.
Calculate that. We find a p-value of 0.0178 as weight is good for us. So what does that mean?
Now you guys are on to S. Summarize your conclusion. Make sure you do it in context.
So seeing that it's 0.0178, that's less than the significant level of 5%, which makes it significant, which means we have to reject the null hypothesis, right? Wade?
Right.
Wade?
Right.
So then, we must... Alright, now that we've done that, we can state our conclusion. And our conclusion would be that we reject the null hypothesis that the sample proportion of vending machines having jammed drinks equals 3%, and we find evidence for the alternate hypothesis that sample proportion of jammed drinks in vending machines is not equal to 0.03, based on our p-value of 0.0178. What's next, Wade? It says we have to construct and interpret a 95% confidence interval.
Use the formula that I've left for you on the board.
Confidence interval, 95%.
Well, Wade's given us a formula right down here. For our confidence interval, it's our p-hat plus or minus z-star times the square root of s, which is standard deviation, over n. So when we did our confidence interval in the calculator, we have the stat test, a one proportion z-interval, we did our x, 2, our n 300, as we did in our last test, and our confidence level of 95%. Calculate that. And we get a confidence interval between negative 0.0013 and 0.02126.
Yeah. Thanks, Wade.
Bye, guys. Good luck on your next mission.
Let's go, Kim.
Oh, look. An E. On pain reliever and a band-aid? What could this mean?
Probably the nurse's office.
Good evening!
You've got the clue! Get it, Ron! Let's go!
Alright, here's the third assignment. An experiment on the side effects of pain relievers assigned severe headache patients to one of several over-the-counter pain medications. Of the 440 patients who took one brand of pain reliever, 23 suffered some adverse symptom.
Does the experiment provide strong evidence that fewer than 10% of patients who take this medication have adverse symptoms? Perform an appropriate test.
Describe a type 1 and type 2 error in this situation. Which is more serious?
Ron, the assignments are getting more and more difficult. We need help. What are we going to do?
I have just the thing. I've never told you this before, but... I'm James Bond.
With Q. And M.
Q, what do you mean, Ron is James Bond?
I don't know. It was like, one second he was Ron, the next he was James Bond.
Kim, you need to get to work.
Okay.
Find E.
Bond, this is M. The clue is in the microwave.
Let's go.
There's the clue!
Let's see what it says.
Okay. Difference in calcium levels in whole and 1% milk are shown as the following chart. Construct and interpret a 95% confidence interval for the difference in mean calcium levels using Table B to find the critical value of T. You're getting closer.
And there's the E.
Well, looking at
assignment 4. How do we construct a 95% confidence interval for something with two means?
You must first enter the data into your calculator and use the two-sample T and Z interval test with the confidence level that you were given from the problem to find the value at which you are most confident the data is between mu1 and mu2. You have to remember that this is a T-interval problem because you were given samples, not a population.
Now that we know what it is, what do we do first?
In order to compare two means, you must first state your two hypotheses, H-null and H-alternate. And then, in order to compare the two means, your samples must be from two SRSs, from two distinct populations. Both populations must be normally distributed, and the responses of each group must be independent of those in another group.
Well, the null hypothesis for this experiment would be that the mean calcium levels in whole milk is the same as the mean calcium levels in 1% milk.
Then the alternative hypothesis would be that the mu of whole is not equal to the mu of 1% milk. So now I think we should enter the data into our L1 and L2 list.
Well, guys, if you put the data in L1 and L2 of your gadget watch, and then you make a scatter plot, you can find a trend in the data, which should be able to tell you if it's normal. You guys should also make sure that the population is at least 10 times the size of your sample. You should also be aware of the margin of error formula, which is z star times the square root of p hat times 1 minus p hat over the number of observations.
Well, seeing that our sample size is 9, and 9 times 10 is 90, obviously our population of milk in the school is going to be over 90, so that also helps with our assumptions.
And the next assumption that Hugh just talked about was our normal probability plot to prove that our data is normal. So we go to Stat, Edit, and enter our data into the two lists, and we can go to second stat plot, turn it on, and make a scatter plot using our two lists, and hit graph. If you can't see it correctly, you can go to zoom down to statistic, and you can see a large amount of scatter. So that means that our data is approximately normal, so that helps to prove our assumption and lead us into our test.
Yes.
If you would like to perform a confidence interval test by hand, you can use the formula p hat plus or minus z star times the square root of p hat times 1 minus p hat over the number of observations, but I think it'd be better off in your gadget watch bond.
Alright, in order to carry out our confidence interval for this assignment, we gotta go to stat and look at our types of tests we have. Scroll down until we see two sample t interval for our confidence interval. Make sure we're in data because we have our data entered into two lists. And don't worry about frequency. Go to our confidence level. We want it at 0.95 or 95% as stated in our problem. You never want to pull this type of data. So we have to calculate. And we find a confidence interval of 2.3476 and 8.2968 with in all our values of our means, our standard deviations, also our degrees of freedom.
So based on our test, we can be 95% confident that the mean of whole 1% comes between 2.3476 and 8.2968. And because of these numbers, we can reject the null hypothesis, and we find evidence for the alternate hypothesis that the mean calcium levels in whole milk and the mean calcium levels in 1% milk are not equal, because if they were equal, then there would be a zero within this range. Right.
How do we know where the clue is? Why are we outside?
Q, tell me where the bloody clue is.
This is it. Look in the bush.
Hey, look. There it is.
Sign the clock. A report said caterpillars who were given a supplement deviated in their breeding date more than caterpillars who were not. The data is shown for two groups of randomly selected caterpillars. Perform a significance test to see if the supplemented caterpillars differ from the breeding date from the control.
The Examinator.
We must be getting closer.
How do we solve this problem? We haven't learned any of this.
I believe I can be some help.
Thank you.
What do you guys need help with?
Well, we have to perform a significance test to see if the supplemented caterpillars differ from their breeding date from the control caterpillars.
So basically, we need a significance test for two means.
Well, that's quite simple, actually. All you have to do is first you must state your hypothesis, which is your edge null and your edge alternate. And then you have to check out your assumptions, which means you have to have an SRS, must be normal, and you have to have independence. Furthermore, then you have to do your test. Your test, you put it in your gadget watch bone, and it will give you the results of your two-sample test. And then you will state your conclusion, and you'll have your answer.
Okay, so our null hypothesis is that the supplemented caterpillars and the control caterpillars have the same breeding date, but they don't differ very much. And our alternate would be that they do differ.
Right, Ron. I mean, James. Our assumptions would be that as an SRS is normal and both are independent of each other, which we can use from all three.
Because they have safety in the problem.
Yes.
So then, we have to go to our test. And for this test, we have to put our data, the L1 and L2, in my gadget watch. And once we have that entered, we go to our test options in our calculator. And our two-sample t-test, because these are samples, of course, Q, thank you for informing us of that.
Thank you, 007.
And the data, and we make sure we have L1 and L2 in the calculator.
And make sure the hypothesis is not equal to.
Not equal. Calculate that, and we come out with a t-value of -3.99, which is very large, actually, very small, and a p-value of 0.0029.
Excellent work.
With a p-value this small, 0.0029, this makes it that it is very significant on the 5% confidence level, which means that we reject no hypothesis that control caterpillars and supplemented caterpillars are equal, and we find evidence for the alternate hypothesis that the mean values of the control and supplemented caterpillars are not equal.
Excellent work.
Comes the next clue.
Yes.
Next clue.
Bond, Q, you must solve the sixth assignment in order to defeat the Examinator. Oh, and one more thing. You do have a license to kill.
Bond, Intel has led me to believe that the answer to your next clue is in the computer lab. Report back to MI6 when you're finished.
Right here! Rufus, get the clue!
Looking for the Examinator!
Rufus, get the clue! We got it! Thanks, Rufus! Alright, let's go!
Simon.
It's the last one.
It is. And it says, a sample survey by Nielsen Media Research looked at a computer access and the use of the internet. Whites were significantly more likely than blacks to own a home computer, but the black-white difference in computer access at work was not significant. The study team then looked separately at the households with annual incomes of at least $40,000. The sample contained 1,916 white and 131 black households. Here are the sample counts for these households. Blacks owned a home computer were 86, whites owned a home computer 1,173, blacks who had computer access to work was 100, and whites who had computer access to work was 1,132.
Do higher income blacks and whites differ significantly at the 5% level in the proportion who own home computers? Do they differ significantly in the proportion who have computer access at work? Give appropriate statistical evidence to justify your answers.
Enter if you dare.
The Examinator.
The sixth clue. This is going to be the hardest one. We're probably going to need a lot of help.
Q, where are you?
Bond! The Examinator! He's got me!
The Examinator's got him? We've got to hurry!
Call Wade.
Wade! We need your help!
What's the sitch, Kim?
We need help with this last assignment.
What type of problem is it?
It's a two-proportion test. We've got two proportions, and we're supposed to find a significance test.
at the 5% level.
Okay, before you start, there's something you need to know. Here's the formula for standard error. You won't need it for this problem, but it might help in your defeat of the examinator.
Standard error of proportion 1 minus proportion 2 is equal to the square root of proportion 1 times 1 minus proportion 1 over n1 plus proportion 2 times 1 minus proportion 2 over n2.
And all of that is the square root of.
Now, for a two-sample proportion test, here's what you need to know. You must separate the SRS for each population or the responses from two treatments in a randomized comparative experiment. Also, the difference compares the population proportions by proportion 1 minus proportion 2 and the sample proportion 1 minus sample proportion 2. For your significance test, you will need this combined sample proportion formula. Look up.
Thanks, Wade. Let's see. The significance test for the sample proportion equals the count of successes in both examples combined divided by the count of individuals in both samples combined, or x1 plus x2 over n1 plus n2. That's pretty simple enough. Now we need to perform our test.
To perform our test in the calculator, we go to stat, test, and find our two proportion z-test. We have different values we must input for x1, m1, x2, and n2. For the first part of this problem, to prove if blacks and whites differ significantly at the 5% level and the proportion you own home computers, we must enter the home information. So for blacks, it would be 86 for our x value, 131 for our n value, and for whites, it would be 1,173 for our x value, and 1,916 for our n2 value. And we set them not equal to each other, because they must differ. We calculate. That gives us a p-value of 0.314, which would mean, in this case, it would not be significant at the 5% level. Now, for the second part of the problem, we are testing the proportion who have computers access at work. So we would go back to our two-proportion z-test and enter 100 for blacks, according to our chart that was described earlier, out of the 131. And for whites, we would enter 1,132 out of our 1,916, set them not equal to each other. And it looks like this is significant because we have a p-value of 9.5 times 10 to the negative fifth, an extremely small p-value.
Knowing this, for the second part of the problem, we would reject our null hypothesis that the income for blacks and whites is significant to having a computer access at work, and we would find evidence for the alternate hypothesis that their incomes differ for computer access at work based on our p-value of 0.095.
You guys have completed the sixth assignment. Now we must find the examinator.
But how do we do that? Maybe there's a clue in one of the dead bodies. Let's look.
What's that, Rufus? I think he's found the clue. Let's
see what it says. Find Kim Possible and the other guy, Ron, James Bond, and take them out. Report back to room 2104.
The examinator. We're finally going to be able to find him.
He must be in room 2104.
Let's go.
There it is!
The Examinator! We meet at last!